Let's go back to our circuits, and I'll show you how to make these plots without having to use a computer program. There's a simplified way of making a plot called the Bode method. We're going to make Bode plots right now. Here's what they look like. They're basically straight line approximations to these graphs. First of all, we know that these are low pass filters because of the way they look or because of the transfer functions. Therefore, we know that for low frequencies, we're going to get a line at 0 decibels. Because they're single pole filters, we also know that there's going to be a 20 decibel per decade roll off at the high frequencies. The only thing that we don't know is where these two lines come together. Well, it happens when omega t equals 1, as we just saw, or when omega equals 1 over t. T is the time constant. So in the RC low pass filter, the time constant is RC. Therefore, the turning point in an RC filter is going to be 1 over RC. The frequency, by the way, is measured in radians per second. So if you want to convert the frequency to hertz, there's a factor of a 2 pi that you also have to contend with. If we now look at the phase plots, we also notice that for low frequencies, the phase is very close to 0 degrees. For high frequencies, it gets very close to negative 90 degrees. But it's worth pointing out that in neither case does the phase shift actually ever get to 0 or negative 90 degrees. It's bounded by these two numbers. What if you actually use these filters now in a circuit? What could potentially change the action of the filter or change its corner frequency? Well, one thing that you could possibly want to do with the filter is attach a load to it. A load is normally a resistor. So what happens to the filter if you attach a load resistor to it? Well, you might immediately notice that all of our equations are going to change because of the presence of the load resistor. Adding a load resistor to a filter will probably change its corner frequency, and that's something that we have to be aware of. The load itself can alter the characteristics of the filter, except in the case where the load has a very large resistance. If the resistance here, for example, is large relative to the resistor over here, and it's also large relative to the reactance of the capacitor, or 1 divided by omega C, which also has units of ohms, then it's not going to affect the corner frequency of the circuit very much. So if the load is large, or if it has a very high resistance, then the filter will probably work as designed. But the minute you start making that resistor too small, then our filter might not work as designed. Now, the same thing can happen on the input side too. If you happen to have a source that has a non-negligible impedance, this resistor will add to the resistor here in your filter, and it's going to alter the corner frequency of the filter. Of course, you could compensate for it, but it's something that you have to be aware of when you're designing filters. Both sources and loads can affect the performance of a filter, and we'll see how to get around that limitation in another video. Now, we've looked at low-pass filters. I now want to take a look at the high-pass filters. How are they different from the low-pass filters? Well, here are two examples. We have one example of an RC filter and an example of an LR filter. They're very similar to the low-pass filters. The only thing that's different is that in the RC filter, the resistor and capacitor have swapped locations, and in the LR filter, the inductor and resistor have also swapped locations. So swapping resistors and capacitors can convert a low-pass filter into a high-pass filter. Let's go ahead and derive the transfer function for both of these circuits here. In the numerator is our load R, and in the denominator is the impedance of the whole circuit. Let's now multiply every fraction here by j omega c. If I write j omega as s, then I have our transfer function h in terms of s. Let's divide everything by rc in order to isolate s in the denominator. What can we conclude now from our transfer function about the number of poles? Well, I see that it has only one s in the denominator. For example, it's not s squared or s cubed, it's just s down here. Therefore, this is the transfer function of a one-pole filter. When we looked at low-pass filters, we didn't have any s in the denominator, but we have an s here. This is called a zero. That's a key difference between a low-pass filter and a high-pass filter. Low-pass filters have poles, but not zeros. High-pass filters have both zeros and poles. Let's take a look at the other circuit, and you'll see that we get something similar. We have our inductor in the load position, and then we have the whole circuit in the denominator here. I would now again like to isolate S in the denominator by dividing everything by L. We can again see right away that we have one pole and one zero. We can again recognize RC as a time constant. We can again recognize L over R as a time constant. Although these two circuits look different from one another, the resistors are not in the same spots. One has a capacitor and the other has an inductor. Although they look different, these two circuits do exactly the same thing because the equation that we get for the transfer function works out to be the same. Let's take a look at the plot of this transfer function. Since we're plotting the magnitude of the transfer function, let's show how it's derived. We have a complex number, so let's take the absolute value of the numerator and the absolute value of the denominator too. If we stare at this equation, we can get an idea for how it behaves at low frequencies and at high frequencies. First of all, at low frequencies, especially in the denominator, the 1 starts to make more of a difference, or the denominator starts to approach 1. With a very small numerator and a very large denominator, the transfer function approaches 0. On a log scale, we're never really going to get to 0 unless we're clear over here at negative infinity off to the left of the graph. Therefore, our line just keeps going down and down and down, and the intersection with the 0 point is actually at negative infinity here, the way we're graphing it. But at DC, the transfer function equals 0. That's true from the graph here as well. Now, as the frequency gets higher and higher in the denominator here, the 1 starts to matter less and less because it's overwhelmed by the omega squared term. If the 1 is neglected in the denominator, then the denominator just approaches omega t. The numerator, then, divided by the denominator, just approaches 1. 1 is 0 decibels when plotted here on the log scale. We can see that at high frequencies, all of the signals are able to get through the filter, which is what we expect for a high-pass filter. As the frequency gets lower and lower, the signal starts to become blocked. The frequency at which exactly half of the power gets through, or the corner frequency, is given when omega equals 1 over t. Here's what the phase plot looks like. Let's again derive a formula that would be able to yield this phase plot. I'm again going to multiply both the numerator and the denominator by the complex conjugate of the denominator in order to get a single complex number. We have here a real part and an imaginary part. Let's plot it on the complex plane to see where that point might lie. So we need to move a certain distance along the real axis, and then we need to move a certain distance up the imaginary axis as well. If we're trying to plot the phase, we're interested in knowing this angle phi. That angle phi is given by the arctangent of the imaginary part divided by the real part. We can see that the arctangent is going to give us an angle that's between 0 degrees and positive 90 degrees. For very high frequencies, there's no phase shift induced by the filter. For very low frequencies, the filter induces a positive 90 degree phase shift. It turns out that for every reactive component in a filter, you're able to get up to 90 degrees of phase shift in either direction, depending on how the component is arranged, but never more than 90, right? So if you have a filter that has only a single capacitor or a single inductor in it, you're never going to get, say, 125 degrees of phase shift from that filter. You need two poles in order to do something like that. Let's take a look at the Bode plots. If you can identify a filter as a high-pass filter, it's possible to make the plots without a computer. You can just make straight line approximations. We know that for every pole in a filter, we're going to get a change of 20 decibels per decade. It turns out for the high pass filters, we're going to have a 20 decibel per decade rise until we get to the corner frequency, and then the pole is going to cause that rise to clamp down to a flat line right at 0 dB. The corner frequency is given in radians per second by 1 divided by t, where t is the time constant. Again, we have the same sorts of restrictions with high-pass filters as we had with low-pass filters. If you hook a load up to a high-pass filter, then the load resistor can affect the filter's performance if that resistance is too small. Likewise, for the source, if the source has a source impedance that's too high relative to all the reactances or resistances of your filter itself, then it can also alter the filter's performance or change the filter's corner frequency. So that's something to be aware of. Let's now summarize what we've learned about single pole filters by plotting out where these poles and zeros lie in the complex plane. We've looked at two different low pass filters, and I've noted down our transfer functions. We've looked at two high pass filters, and I've also taken note of the transfer functions. For the low pass filters, you might notice that there's no S in the numerator at all. Therefore, they don't have any zeros. However, we do have an S here in the denominator. Since we only have one S, it's a single pole filter. How do you find the poles, or where do you find the location of the poles? Well, if we take the denominator and set it equal to zero and solve for s, that will tell us the location of the poles. So if I take the denominator and solve it for s, I'm just going to get s equals minus 1 over rc. For the second filter here, if I take the denominator and just set it equal to zero, I'm going to wind up with s equals minus r over l. If we now imagine that the s is an entire complex plane with a real and imaginary axis, then I can note the location of the poles on the complex plane. In this case, both of the poles are real. Minus 1 over rc is not an imaginary number, it's not a complex number, it's just a real number. So we can plot it here with an x. That's the location of the pole. And there's only one pole because we didn't have, for example, s squared or s cubed or s to the fourth power in the denominator. We just had s, therefore we only had one pole. Now, these pole zero diagrams that I'm now going to show you how to make are useful for understanding a filter's behavior by inspection. It's not really useful here for the one pole filters, but you'll see what I mean later when we look at higher order filters. If we now look at the high pass filters, we might notice that for the numerator, we do have an s present. Let's set the numerator equal to zero and solve for s. Well, it's trivial here. We just get s equals zero. Zero lies right in the center of the complex plane. So let's mark it with a big O. That's where the zero is. We get the same solution for our second filter, our LR filter. These two filters have a single zero, and we've plotted it here in the complex plane. These filters also have a single pole, and the location of that pole is the same as it was in the low pass case. We can now see graphically or visually what the difference between a high pass filter and a low pass filter is. A low pass filter has a pole, no zero. A high pass filter has a zero and a pole, and the zero happens to be right at the origin. When we look at higher order filters, we'll see how this concept generalizes. For now, I just want to show you what the pole and the zero actually do when it comes to the transfer function or the plot of the transfer function. Let's take a look. I'll write down what a pole does in words, and then we'll apply it to these two graphs. A pole causes a minus 20 decibel per decade bend at the corner frequency. Right here at the corner frequency, or omega equals 1 over tau, we have a bend. For our low-pass filter, we started off with a flat line, or 0 decibels per decade. And then when we got to the corner frequency, the line took a dive, and it started changing at negative 20 decibels per decade. That's what a pole does. Now, what does a zero do? A zero does almost the opposite of a pole. A zero causes a plus 20 decibel per decade bend. But where does it cause this 20 decibels per decade bend? Well, it causes it at the location of the zero. The zero, as you might recall, happened here at the origin, where s equals zero, or omega equals zero. Therefore, far left here on the graph, at a frequency of omega equals zero, the zero caused a plus 20 decibel per decade bend. That's where we got this upward rising line to start with. It was caused by the zero. Now, what happens here when we get to the corner frequency, or the frequency that's affected by the pole? Well, then the pole takes over, and the pole causes a negative 20 decibel per decade bend. Right here at the corner frequency, the pole subtracts 20 decibels per decade from what we already had, and we wind up with 0 decibels per decade. You might have noticed that we have some design freedom here. If we intend to design a filter to have a corner frequency, then that corner frequency is going to be a function of RC. Should we choose a large resistor and a small capacitor? Or should we choose a large capacitor and a small resistor? In the next video, I'm going to look at this question in a little bit more detail so that you can make smart design decisions when you're designing your filters.